And Imam al-Bayhaqi, may Allah have mercy on him, reported it, and it was classified as authentic by al-Albani, may Allah have mercy on him, on the authority of Abdullah ibn Shifri, may Allah be pleased, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مثل ابن آدم وإلى جنبه تسعة وتسعون بنية مثل ابن آدم وإلى جنبه تسعة وتسعون بنية إن أفدك المنايا وقع في الهرم حتى يموت إن أفلتته المنايا وقع في الهرم حتى يموت The similitude of the son of Adam is like that of a man who is surrounded with 99 calamities, things that cause death, war, burnt to death, drowning, accidents, whatever, things that lead to death. If all of these calamities miss him, then he will live and reach an old age and die. So the point is, or the similitude here is bringing out and highlighting the fact that death is something that is certain regardless of how. Whether there is a cause behind it or a reason for it or not. And Imam Ali Qadi, may Allah have mercy on him, said that the number 99 is not meant for itself. It is just to reflect a large number. Meaning regardless of how large the number of the possibilities of death that surround the person, he gets killed and he's recovered. He gets into an accident and he comes out of it. He drowns and he's brought back to life or he's rescued for saving. So on and so forth. If all these miss him, death will take place by him growing old and eventually dying. You see, we live through this life and we're heedless of the end of our lives. It's like someone sleeping and waking up too late. We must take lessons from the rapid elapse of days and nights. Just yesterday, or it feels as if though, it feels as if it was just yesterday. We were in high school, longing to reach college so we can get into the college life, and then once we reached it, we couldn't wait to graduate so we can work and get married and form a Muslim family. But then, shortly after, our children got married. And we became grandparents. It feels so short, yet there are years after years who pass between these two points. And we were simply heedless of all that. We were not awake. We were not focused. We all visit graves. We've all been in graveyards and saw how dead people were put in that hole. But how often did we think that this is a reality that's going to strike every single one of us, including me? That one day, this is going to be my hole. This is going to be my grave. Regardless of how None of that matters. It's a reality. Every soul is gonna die. Every life will come to an end. Allah said, "Kullu nafsin da'iqatul maut." Every soul will taste death. Look at the term used, taste, because it's a bitter taste than this. And you'll only take your full compensation on the day of resurrection. See, death does not distinguish between young and old. Healthy and ill, rich and poor, it doesn't matter. When the time comes, it comes. That person is departing. Everyone will have to depart. And there is no escape. Jibreel alayhi salam, may Allah exalt his mention, addressed Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is narrated by Sahih al-Sa'd. May Allah be pleased with him. Reported by Al-Bayhaqi and classified as sound by Al-Imam. He said, "O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, live for as long as you want, you will eventually die. And love whomever you want, you will eventually leave them." There is no escape from that. Regardless of how hard we try, as Allah said, "Qul inna al-mawta alladhi tafirruna minhu fa innahu mulaqikum." Say, O Muhammad, the death that you try to flee from, indeed, it will meet you. ثم تردون إلى عالم الغيب والشهادة فينبئكم بما كنتم تعملون. Then, and that's what we have to worry about. And then you will be returned to the knower of the seen and the unseen, the hidden and the present. And he will inform you with all that she did. Allah had decreed that everything, not only souls, not only humans, everything will perish. Everything will perish. Allah says in the Quran, "Kullu shay'in halikun illa wajhah." Everything will perish except his face, meaning except Allah. And guess what? Even death will perish. Yes. Al-Sayyidin will be narrated, and this is reported by Imam Bukhari, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, on the day of resurrection, death will be brought in the form of a white ram, and it will be placed between hell and paradise. And then a call will be made, "O people of Jannah, O people of Paradise, do you recognize this?" They will extend their necks and look out to see, and they will say, "Yes, it is death." And then another call will be made, "O people of hell, do you recognize this?" And they will extend their necks and look and say, "Indeed, it is death." Then Allah commands and that is slaughtered. That ground is slaughtered. And another call is made, a different call than the one before it, a one that brings glad tidings and extremely bad news. Glad tidings for the dwellers of Jannah, of paradise, and a miserable news for those in hell. Yeah.
Oh.
said, who can cure him? The dying person. And he is serving them. It's too late. But that's when he becomes certain. He is certain, the dying person becomes certain that he is the part of life. And the leg is moved about the leg to your lower. On that day is the procession. Brothers, sisters, if there is nothing scary about death except the moment of death and the hardships one experiences at the moment of death, it would have been enough. It would have been enough for one to become serious about his death, to become serious about Akhirah, and to always remind himself about it. So how is the case when death is only the beginning? When it is only the initial state of the hereafter, after which there is the darkness of the grave, that fine, sharp ridge over Jahannam that leads to paradise, accountability. Are we ready? I ask Allah to enable us to get ready for that moment. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله ولي الصالحين، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الصادق الأمين صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما بعد، what is the wisdom behind death? Well, the wisdom is to be tested. Who amongst us fulfills the state of servitude to Allah? Who amongst us will be the most obedient to Allah in the best manner? As Allah says in the Quran, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. He is the one who has created death and life. And notice Allah mentioned death before life, because this life is insignificant in all aspects and in all measures. It is death and then life. لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, in order to test you, who amongst you or which of you will be the best in deeds. Therefore, we must utilize our lives. Moments are counted. Our breaths are counted. Time is short, and we have no time to waste. So why is it that we spend a lot of times doing things that don't please Allah? Why do we waste our lives in such matters? And then, at the time of death, we regret. Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahmatullahi alayhi, Allah have mercy on him, said, when a person is deprived from performing good deeds, he's just miserable. He's deprived. At the moment of death, he will find nothing but sorrow and regret. And would wish that he can be delayed or returned in order to perform good deeds. But it's nothing but a mirage. It's too late. Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونِ لَعَلِّي Until the time when death comes to one of them, he will say, "Oh my Lord, return me, bring me back, so I can act righteous in that which I have left behind, meaning in life." But the answer comes, "Kalla,
no,
innaha kalimatun huwa qa'iluha." It is not that a word is uttering. "Wa min wara'ihim barzakh ila yawmi yub'athun." And behind them is a barrier, the barrier of death, until the day they are resurrected. It's too late then. So, was this the case with our predecessors? Is this how our Salaf, our righteous predecessors, dealt with death or felt about death? Indeed not. At the time of death, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu cried. So people asked him about the reason. He's crying. He said, "By Allah, I am not leaving on this life, on the pleasures of this worldly life. Rather, I am crying because ahead of me is a long journey." That's the real journey. "And I have so little as provisions. And I am about to ascend an obstacle, which is death, the descent of which would lead to either hell or paradise. And I do not know what's going to happen to me." This is Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, was one of the companions, may Allah be pleased with them, who narrated the most of the authority of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ata, rahmatullahi alayhi, as-Sulami, may Allah have mercy on him, was visited during his death illness and started crying. So people asked him, "Why are you crying? How do you feel?" He said, "I feel that death is at my neck, meaning my soul is about to depart, and my grave is ahead of me, and my stance is going to be on the day of resurrection. And my way leading to Jannah is a very fine, sharp, rich sirat that lies over the fire of hell. And I'm not certain where my end is going to be." We need to deal with death in this manner. We need to deal with death as our role models and leading examples dealt with death. So, it's mandatory to hasten to repentance. First of all, because Allah commanded us to repent. And return in repentance to Allah, all of you, all believers. And secondly, because we always err and make mistakes and sin. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the narration narrated by Anas, May Allah be pleased with him. And reported by Ibn Majah, may Allah have mercy on him, and classified as sound by Al-Bani. He, alayhi salatu wasalam, said, all the children of Adam commit sins, make mistakes. But the best of those who make mistakes are those who repent. So we need to repent. We need to take the opportunity of being alive. We need to take advantage of this moment before it goes away, before time slips, before we know it. Oh, you who have neglected your prayer, repent. Oh, you who have attached your heart to music and songs, to celebrities of artists and musicians and sport people, repent. Oh, you who have neglected his family and his wife, his children, who are abandoning their salah, repent to Allah. Sister who has shut hijab, half of her hair is exposed, makeup, perfume, repent to Allah Azza wa Jal. Don't misuse your tongue in gossip and backbiting. Repent to Allah. Repent to Allah before it's too late. And fear Allah. فَاتَّقُوا يَوْمًا تُرْجَعُونَ فِيهِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. And fear a day that you will be returned to Allah. Fear a day when you will be returned to Allah. But we must remember one thing, that repentance has a time limit. What is the time limit? Before the soul reaches the confines. وليس التوبة للذين يعملون السيئات حتى إذا حضر أحدهم الموت قال إني تبت لله. Repentance is not accepted from the one who continuously sins, performs evil deeds until the time of death comes. He says, I will repent now. It's too late. Ibn Kathir commented on this verse saying, when one gives up hope in life, in living again, and sees the angel of death, repentance is of no avail. It's not accepted at that time. We need to take advantage of our lives. Let's pledge to Allah now, as we're sitting now. Perhaps if we die with good intention. Let's pledge to Allah Azza wa Jal to repent from our mistakes and sins, to rectify our affairs, our shortcomings, to take care of ourselves, our deen, our akhirah, take care of those whom we are entrusted with, wives and children. Perhaps Allah Azza wa Jal will accept this intention and help us reform ourselves.